Hello, I'm Lakeisha Bennett, and you're listening to the MetaVance podcast series. In this podcast, we're focusing on the 37th Annual Training Institute on Behavioral Health and Addictive Disorders Conference. It takes place in Clearwater Beach, Florida in February of 2016. And today we're joined by one of the guest speakers, Doug McGurk, who's the Vice President of Training and Development with Palm Healthcare Company. Thank you for joining us, Doug.
Thank you for having me.
So just tell us a little bit about the conference and why you believe it's necessary to take part in it.
Well, my experience with U.S. Journal has been very good, and the fact that they're so supportive of the therapy and the therapists and being on the forefront of providing as much information and education for the changes that are happening in the field and really being on top of being sure that everyone is getting the education that they need, because it is really difficult when we're bogged down with doing our work that sometimes there are changes that happen in the industry, things that are effective or maybe not as effective anymore, the change of clientele, that now it's a really good time to continue offering new routes to success and making a difference in people's lives.
How long have you been attending this particular conference?
About 4 years.
Okay, awesome. What, I guess, in your opinion, kind of sets it apart? You're mentioning you've been working with the U.S. Journal for a while now. I guess, what kind of sets them apart from other conferences in behavioral healthcare?
Obviously, their support of content, you know, with all the books and all of that that they have with the, you know, HCI, they really do their best to be sure that they're supporting new information getting out there that can leave. You know what I mean? Like, you go to some conferences and, you know, after you leave, you're done. And the great thing with U.S. Journal is that they have the content right there, and you can meet with some of the authors and be able to dig in a little deeper and get their books and be able to take that home with you as well. And it's important that people don't become the conference sort of junkie, meaning, you know, they go to every conference, but they don't necessarily have the opportunity to apply or really take the stuff home. And the U.S. Journal stuff has real take homes. You can actually come home with a book.
Awesome. Yeah. So in this conference, you're going to be speaking, and your presentation is entitled Rules and Values, Essential Elements of the Blueprint of Success. Can you just tell us about that presentation?
Sure. What we found is when we dig a little deeper into what guides the decisions that we make, they're based on what's important to us. You know, what do we value? What are the states, the emotions, you know, kind of what guides the decisions that we make? Are we going to get pain or pleasure from this, right? We have those two opposing forces. And then what is important about that? And then the other thing, which we don't even realize, is how do we know we're experiencing that emotion, whether it's one that we're looking to avoid or one that we're looking to experience? And what we do find is, not to give the program away, but we're wired for non-pain. Mm-hmm. Meaning our pain sensors are outnumbered by our pleasure centers 10 to 1. So what happens is we actually spend a lot more energy trying to avoid pain as opposed to really creating joy in our lives. And then we have these rules that are creating discord, mm-hmm. that we're actually creating a system, a rule system. It's like going to a game. Like, if you went to a game and a football game, let's say, and they handed you the ball, but you didn't know how to play the game. Mm-hmm. How would that go for you, do you think?
Standing there, I guess, looking at the ball and I guess trying to figure
out. You might get hit.
Yeah.
You're holding that ball, and one of the rules that you're unaware of is when someone has the ball, tackle them. Mm-hmm. Well, in pretty short order, you may just go, oh, okay, I just learned this rule. Don't hold the ball, because if I do, I experience pain. But if no one told you, well, if you took that ball and you ran in a certain direction and you could pass it in this way, you wouldn't get the most out of life. So oftentimes we're not living this full, rich life because our rules are not designed for us to get that value of life, to get the joy, to get the juice. And then it's really easy to experience all this pain. All I got to do to experience pain is hold the ball. Mm-hmm. And that would be a really challenging way to go through life. So what we find in people in recovery or people who struggle with addiction is that they've created an environment in a game that the rules are wired in a way that makes it really difficult to be successful. And what they value, they don't even have a real understanding as to what's most important to them. What are the emotions? If you think about it, people who struggle with addiction, one of the things, especially if it's an opiate addiction, is they're just wanting to avoid all feelings. Mm-hmm. So they're just valuing no feelings. And then the rules in which they have to experience that can be really, really interesting. Sometimes they're really easy to meet, pain, hold the ball and get hit, and really difficult to experience joy or pleasure. They don't even know where to run. So the way you experience pleasure is by not holding on to the ball, but you can't win the game if you're not holding on to the ball, if you're not controlling the ball.
Okay.
If that analogy made sense.
It
got a little esoteric here. If I don't know if you like football. I don't particularly play football or know a whole lot about it, but that's why I don't play, because I don't know the rules.
But yeah, that actually did make a lot of sense. You don't know about it and you're sitting there holding the ball, you become a target and you're going to get hit. So I guess if you don't know about it, you're going to, try to get rid of it to avoid that pain. But yeah, I guess if you were taught, this was actually a very good analogy there. Can you just tell us more about your background? It says you're an accomplished entrepreneur, musician, and producer, inspirational speaker. Can you just tell us, I guess, why you're passionate about this industry in particular?
Sure. So my original career was working in music. Worked on several Grammy-winning records, worked with Celine Dion, Mariah Carey, Jennifer Lopez, tons of those pop artists and some rock artists, and worked on some television shows and some Emmys for all those kinds of things. And what I started out as an artist, and I got into production and engineering and so forth because the records I was making for myself, I wasn't particularly caring for, and it just wasn't sounding the way I wanted it to sound. So I decided to learn about it, knowing that I had to either hire the right people or at least communicate to those people, or sometimes, if I had to do it myself. So I got a lot of joy out of learning how to bring that music out of other people, because that's what I first learned. As I dug deeper, what I realized was helping people, those artists, helping bring out their artistry, their passions, was what really drove me. Going out on tour and playing in all the shows, connecting with the people and giving people, when we would go on stage from anywhere from 45 minutes to 2 hours, it was really powerful to know that I was participating in that shift for that moment. Even if it was just entertainment, when they left, they were able to get out of the doldrums and the challenges of the day, and they were just able to have a release. When I was in the studio, I'd be able to help people. They'd come in with an idea, and I would be able to connect with them and help them create this thing. They'd be like, this is better than I ever imagined, and oh my gosh, you got where I was coming from. And so I realized, like, wow, this is what drives me. And then knowing that the stuff I worked on, all these, millions and millions of records sold, that for a few minutes or the whole, record, there was this person, having that escape as well. So the peak of my career was when Napster happened and technology changed everything, and I realized that I had to make a shift. So I had some of this conversation that I teach with myself, like, why do I do what I do, and how could I do it more? Like, how do I know? What are my rules for success? How is it that I know that I'm making a difference, and what's important to me? And once I started breaking that down, it no longer became, it had to be music. I was like, man, if I could help people make music of their lives, if I could help them not only have a positive impact on somebody and create an environment that they learn and better themselves, they could also go out and do this for someone else, that they could learn how other people think and learn and help them make a difference. That is having like a massive impact, and I don't have to take credit for it, because I don't want the credit for it, because in order for that change to happen, that person needs to take ownership. So if I could do something that creates momentum in change and transformation, that I'm doing God's work now. Now I'm really digging a lot deeper and honoring my creator or God to live to the best of my abilities. So then from there, what I learned at a young age, about 17 years old, I became familiar with Tony Robbins. Are you familiar with Tony?
I have heard his name before. Yeah, I have heard him.
Okay, so back, I'm not going to date myself, but many years ago, I was hip to Tony. He was on infomercials. He's one of the first people, the personal development people who were doing infomercials. And at one point he was on the air 24 hours a day, 7 days a week around the world.
Mm-hmm.
And he had this program called Personal Power, which was a, now I'll date myself a little bit. It was a 30-day program on cassette. So I applied that, basically what was in there in my life at a pretty young age, and it helped me change everything. I kicked drugs and alcohol at a young age. I was able to go out and learn how to be successful in the music industry, and I did it through mentoring, through just finding people who were getting the results I wanted, and then did what they did, and then I got the results they got. Mm-hmm. So I continued to do that and had the success I just shared in music. And then at that shift, I was like, all right, I want to help people. It went back to the question of, okay, well, who's the best? Who can I mentor under? Who can I, you know, apprentice under mm-hmm. to be my mentor? And I had been through a couple of Tony Robbins events, and they were amazing. They were like rock concerts.
Yeah.
But instead of, you know, a band up there, it was, you know, Tony, and instead of listening to just music, there was music and all that, but it was really working on yourself and making a difference, and extraordinarily powerfully.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember I was at my first event, UPW, and Tony was doing a thing on beliefs, and there was a girl, and he would do an intervention to give an example on how this all works and bring it, you know, full circle and so forth. And there was a little girl, she was 12 years old, and her belief was life wasn't worth living.
Hmm.
And she had attempted suicide a number of times, and her family didn't know what to do. And a friend of the family said, I want to bring you, you know, I want to bring her to this event. Like, mm-hmm. it's just, I think Tony could be a big help. And Tony got off the stage and did an intervention with her for about 2 hours. And there wasn't a dry eye in the house. I was bawling just watching this and watching the transformation, more importantly. Mm-hmm. And I looked around the room and I saw everybody else doing that. Like, everybody was just bawling and just so moved by this conversation. And I just remember saying to myself, wow, I said, this is what I got to do. And not so much what Tony did with the girl, because I've now been trained by Tony, and I'm a master practitioner and trainer of neurolinguistic programming and neo-Ericksonian hypnosis and all the tools that Tony has, you know, used and mastered.
Mm-hmm.
What really moved me was the fact that there were, you know, multiple thousands of people who wanted to do the same thing, who wanted to have a positive impact on someone else's life. And that was what really, like, excited me. I was like, man, I want to go out and I want to have that kind of impact, not just with that little girl what happened, but the fact that all these people want to make a difference. And again, that's how you create paradigm shifts, is that's the tipping point.
Mm-hmm.
So the long story short, I found my way to Tony and got a job with him. And again, applying everything that he taught, because quite honestly, I wasn't qualified for the position I got with him.
Mm-hmm.
But I went against the conventional thought process, and I practiced what he preaches. I practiced what other successful people do, and I was unreasonable. I didn't give myself reasons why I couldn't get the gig with him. I decided that I was going to, and I did whatever it took. And mm-hmm. really what it was consistency, was just showing up. It took me about 6 months or so to get the job, and there was a lot of flux and chat change that was going on in the organization when I first started the conversation with them. And the HR person was like, well, you know, these changes, blah, 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 might be a few weeks, I don't know. So I said to her, I said, well, I'm going to be calling you every Friday morning, I'm going to call you, and you don't have to pick up because you know it's going to be me. I'm just telling you, I'm going to call you every Friday. I'm going to leave a story or a joke or something mm-hmm. just to show you that I'm still here. And there was about 6 months that went by with all these challenges and then interviews. And I got to one point in the interview process and the person said, well, this person, you know, meaning me, that I didn't have the sales experience. I didn't have, you know, I was I had my other business, you know, as doing the music, and I also had work with a software company and this stuff, and the HR person took a stand and said, no, actually, this is the only person who did what they said they were going to do. He called me every Friday, like he said he was going to. He's been the most consistent, persistent, and refuses to give up. He's exactly what we do.
Wow.
And that's what pushed me through to the next level. And then after that, you know, I did great with obviously all the other interviews and so forth till I got the job. And I ended up being one of maybe 50 people on the planet who've ever had that position.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, I got in with Palm, because I had the way it worked with Tony with that gig is you traveled around the country and you would stay in an area for 3 to 5 months and you would do trainings and, you know, go into organizations and do sales trainings and peak performance trainings. And then one of the things that I liked to do was offer back more trainings, you know, to dig deeper. And we created like power teams are all over the world where it's people who get together independently, kind of like, you know, work in a program,
mm-hmm.
and they support each other and they, you know, resource share and they hold each other accountable. And I needed a space to do this. And a mutual friend of mine and Tony's, actually in the Tony community, said, oh, I have this friend. He's got I'm not sure what he does. I think something in treatment or something, but, you know, we're friends, but we don't talk about work a whole lot. But I know that he's got an auditorium. I don't know how big it is, but I'm sure he'd let you use it.
Mm-hmm.
So we got connected, and Peter was like, yeah, of course, you know, no problem. And he and his wife came to the event and were like, wow, like this is what we need. Like he's always worked, you know, Peter was in the Tony community, he's been to events and his whole family, and he had brought some people from the environment, you know, from his work, you know, to the same event that I shared earlier, the UPW,
mm-hmm.
but I think it was the first time when we started to connect where he realized, wow, I could bring that kind of training to treatment. I could bring it for my staff and clients.
Mm-hmm.
So we discussed it and worked it out and said, yeah, you know, let's, you know, for me, this was a great opportunity to have that same kind of impact, to have that ripple effect, to help people who struggle with addiction become practical psychologists for themselves and to help others. Because if you're working a program, you got to be a sponsor. Well, you know, no one trains you to be a sponsor except other sponsors. And maybe there's some, you know, cool things that people could be learning that could make them more effective.
Mm-hmm.
So I saw it as a huge opportunity to make that huge difference. So so my wife and I actually came here. I left working with Tony and started working here at Palm and bringing the seminar style kind of work to the treatment world, and also to leadership development and really learning how to helping people learn how to be better influencers, influencing themselves and others.
Mm-hmm.
So what my wife and I do are a lot of these conference seminar style trainings, as opposed to, you know, just your regular didactic lecture and, you know, here's a worksheet and, you know, do that. We do breakthrough sessions. We do interventions. We do all sorts of things that people don't get unless they go to a seminar, and we've
right.
brought it into the treatment world, and it's been very powerful.
Awesome.
That was a long answer.
No, that's totally fine. That's really fascinating. So that's what you're doing now with Palm, helping with the seminar style workshops in the treatment world. What are your goals there as you're at Palm Healthcare?
So when it comes to the client care, my wife and I developed and run the family program here. So our goals are to educate and inspire and to help facilitate healing of the family dynamic. As you know, addiction is a family disease. It affects the entire family, even if the person thinks it doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes, the families they don't want to admit it necessarily, but they've become addicted to dealing with the problem, and they don't know what to do with themselves when the person maybe gets to go to treatment and starts taking care of themselves, all of a sudden they have, you know, almost an empty nesting, you know, nester syndrome. Mm-hmm. Like, oh my gosh, I've been dealing with this addiction this whole time, and now they're doing the, you know, if they're doing better or they're in treatment, now I, you know, like, I got to keep calling. I got to, you know, we really want to help facilitate the healing process.
Mm-hmm.
So our goal is to help as many families as possible, to help as many people struggling that they can help others, that we can educate and, again, just sort of create these practical psychologists who can help themselves, because our philosophy is pretty simple. Drugs and alcohol were not the problem, they were the solution. And we focus on three pillars all the time, three pillars of transformation.
Mm-hmm.
State management, your state, right? So how you're feeling right now is the state you're in. So if you're a state of anger, state of frustration, state of joy, state of curiosity, whatever it is, it's that's the state you're in.
Mm-hmm.
Drugs and alcohol are not the problem, they're the solution. And when we say solution, really what it means is it's a strategy, and that's the second pillar. Drugs and alcohol, the only reason why someone uses drugs and alcohol is to change how they're feeling. They don't, mm-hmm. if they don't like being angry, then they use it. Or it's an enhancer. Some people, you know, they just wanted, they're feeling happy, and if I use, I feel more happy.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an enhancer, but the presupposition there then is that I'm not as happy as I could be. So mm-hmm. again, it's just a strategy to change how you're feeling. So there's so many different ways that you could change your state, but what happens is people get trained into using drugs or alcohol as the only strategy. And then the last pillar is story. And we're always writing this story. We've got this narrative going all the time, whether it's internal or external, and it's usually both. And the only thing that really stops us from getting the results that we want is that narrative that we keep repeating over and over as to why we don't have those results. And
mm-hmm.
the truth is that oftentimes those stories are pretty messed up. And the problem, though, with that is that most people, when they hear this tragic story, think it's going to be really cold and callous to go, well, yeah, but that was 20 years ago. Like, I get it. And I feel horrible. But if you keep telling the story, the only person you keep re-traumatizing is yourself.
Yeah.
And that sounds really harsh, and no one would say that. And I'm not saying that I say that to anybody who's struggling. I'm not minimizing or saying that these things didn't happen. But when we get into this pattern of running this narrative over and over again about all the wrongs and all the problems and all of that, and then I got to shut that voice off, so then I grab that drug or alcohol to stop telling that story because it's making me feel like crap, putting me in a non-resourceful state,
mm-hmm.
well, now I'm just basically creating the problem for myself. Even though a thing happened, if it's done, if I keep telling the story, I'm just feeling bad about it.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with families. I'm not saying, I'm not minimizing that, you know, someone who, you know, a family member who had something horrible, like their, you know, loved one stole something from them to get their DOC, the drug of choice. I'm not suggesting that that didn't happen, or to pretend it didn't happen, or to minimize it, or anything like that. But the healing starts when you forgive that person and give them the opportunity to make amends. But if you keep beating that person up and keep reminding them of all the pain that they've caused, it leaves no room for healing. And that's just a strategy as well. That person tells that story, you stole from me, you did this, you did that. That's a strategy for them to feel better, because in their mind, the positive intent there is that if I keep telling you how screwed up you were, you won't do it again. But it doesn't leave the space for the next step of the journey, which is that healing. It's the hero's journey. So we do a lot of hero's journey work where we look at, you know, where we're at and where we want to go. And rather than making those obstacles in the past, you know, a reason to use and a reason to give up and a reason to still be angry, etc., we can use it as the obstacle, the mountain that we need to climb in order to get to the success on the other side. You know, those pains, you know, Darth, the new Star Wars is coming out. So those pains are the Darth Vader, as it were, you know, like using the original, you know, release, you know, Luke Skywalker, if all he did was go around saying, you know, once he learned about his father, say, well, that's why I'm going to screw up. That's why I'll never be, you know, successful. I'll never be a Jedi because my father, you know, was Darth Vader and he is a jerk. Right? Mm-hmm. Or I grew up on this crappy planet with, you know, nothing going on. I had no resources available to me, and that's why I can't learn the ways of the Force. Like, that's just a story.
Yeah.
And we wouldn't have cared about Luke Skywalker if he told that story and then people said, oh, yeah, you're right, it's really bad out there, you poor thing, and then gave up. That story would suck. We'd be like, all right, well, what the hell? But the fact that he overcame that, the forces within, and he challenged himself, and he did all of the things that made him earn the title of Jedi, then we go, that's a story. That's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
So once we can reframe these challenges and go, man, that's part of my journey. That's part of my story. These are the obstacles that warriors, that victors experience. Well, now I have an opportunity and somewhere to go. So again, not to minimize the traumas, the challenges, the pains, the hurts, and all of the crazy things that people have done to themselves and to others. I'm just suggesting that maybe if we looked at it as a benefit to making an incredible story, that when we write that story, we choose to use those elements as obstacles that were just in our way, as opposed mm-hmm. to obstacles that stopped us, are very different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's where I guess my passion is in storytelling. I tell a lot of stories. I use all of this because that's one of the ways we learn, is by creating these analogies. So by keeping it simple, the state strategy and story philosophy, we can really just boil it down to, okay, you don't like how you're feeling? Cool. Change it. How do you change it? Here's how, and we get into, you know, it's very simple. We have these three things that are deal with the state you're in. And what are some strategies? Yeah, come up with as many as you want. There's no right or wrong strategy. Is it getting you closer to your ultimate goal? And that's where you got to get back into your rules or values. What do you value? Do you value, you know, what are the emotions that you feel on a regular basis? And then how's that working out for you? And then how do you know? And then you can really start turning this into and designing your system for results. And that's the blueprint, right? So you create that blueprint, that map of, okay, here are the things that I'm looking to accomplish. Here's how I know I'm accomplishing them. Here's how I know I'm not accomplishing them. This is what's most important. And here are the strategies I need to implement to this story that I'm writing, so that at the end of my days, when I look back at my life, I'm saying things like, I'm glad I did, not I wish I had. And that's creating a life worth being sober for. That's the ultimate goal, right? I mean, if you have no reason to be sober, people are going to end up using, because when someone's active, they don't need a reason, right? They just go, oh, it's sunny. Yay. I'm going to use and celebrate. I'm angry. I'm going to use to change my state. I'll show them. I'm depressed. Woe is me. Oh, I'll do, all right? And they just, it doesn't matter what's going on. Mm-hmm. But if you have a really compelling reason not to use, a really compelling reason, more importantly, to stay sober, to keep moving forward, it makes it a lot easier, and it also gives it a lot more sort of value and purpose and fulfills deeper needs to feel like we're here for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the biggest thing is to be like, man, like, what was the point of all this? But if I create something for me, like, oh, you know what, this is what drives me. This is what's going to push me when the going gets tough, and when I get these challenges, and I don't know how to do something, but I, you know what, I know why. So if I know why I want to do it, I'll figure out the how. Because
mm-hmm.
I mean, if you think about it, people who struggle with addiction, they didn't, you know, they got their drugs by any means possible. They didn't care how they got it. They got it.
Mm-hmm.
And once we could reframe that and go, okay, well, your why was, you just needed to change. That was why. Your purpose was get high. Did you care how you got it? Nope. I just had to do it. So you did it. So if we could start creating that same mindset on transformation and recovery and the things that give you that feeling of success, and it doesn't have to be about money. It could be to be the best mother, father, husband, wife, brother, sister. Really not important what the relationship is in that context, but if you want to be the best, you're going to figure out how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you look at like relationships, like dating, when you first meet somebody, what are you willing to do for that person? How many different ways are you willing to get that person's attention? You're going to write them letters. You're going to sing them songs. You're going to hug and kiss them. You're going to spend time with them. You're going to run every strategy you possibly can and hope that one sticks, because mm-hmm. you're focused on your purpose. So that's what's important. And then your rules, you kind of have less rules sometimes at that, because you're willing to try everything. What happens is in life, we fall back to the old patterns without even realizing it. So then you hear those songs like, you don't bring me flowers anymore and all that kind of stuff. That's just a byproduct of someone falling back to old patterns and running the patterns that they're unaware of based on the rules that they were unaware of, based on the values that they were unaware of in a blueprint that they had no idea. So they're back to being given a ball in the middle of a game that they don't know how to play, and they're getting hit every time they grab the ball. And it may not be accurate.
Yeah.
There may be more options. So that's sort of the motivation behind our work here, is to equip people who struggle with as many tools as possible to be as flexible as possible, so that they're not as much worried about how, and they get really clear on why, so they understand what's driving them, what's guiding them, so that they could get the results in sobriety with grace and elegance.
Awesome. Well, yeah, definitely enjoy your stories and analogies. I can definitely tell you're really passionate about this subject, and this subject that you have coming up with this conference, the Blueprint for Success, is definitely something worth attending. Sounds like, is there anything else that you'd like to mention about the conference and just your work now?
No, just, obviously, please come and participate. It's interactive. We usually create an environment where someone can experience this, and that you're doing the work where I'm not just up there sitting and telling stories and running a PowerPoint with all sorts of data on there. It's more about an experience, and that's applicable. So for those, you could ask people who have attended the trainings that I've done with US Journal, that they're at the very least engaging, and the participants have an opportunity to learn something that is easily applied and you can take action on immediately. And then just like to say that, you know, we're looking to offer this in as many ways possible. So if there's anyone who has any suggestions or ideas or ways that they would like something addressed, that we're more than willing and would love to support that process, because our goal is to make sure that people are as effective and productive as possible to heal as many people as possible, so that we can change the face of addiction.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining us, Doug, for this podcast series. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. And just for those of you listening, here's more information on that 37th Annual Training Institute on Behavioral Health and Addictive Disorders. It's being presented by U.S. Journal Training Incorporated, along with the Institute for Integral Development and Counselor Magazine. And it's going to take place from February 22nd through the 25th. It'll be in Clearwater Beach, Florida. And if you would like more information, you can just go to usjt.com. Again, that's usjt.com. Now, we want to thank you for listening to the MetaVance podcast series. It's brought to you by MetaVance Billing Service, the leader in revenue cycle management for behavioral health care providers in toxicology services nationwide. With more than 140 employees and averaging more than $60 million of transmitted claims monthly, MetaVance Billing Service has the manpower, technology, and expertise to increase your facility's revenue. To learn more about MetaVance, just go to MetaVanceBilling.com, or you can call toll-free at 1-888-407-9920.